don't have a child?
Well, if you get pregnant, yes, because you don't get to kill things just because it's in your uterus.
It's my body. How about you just stay out of it?
How about you stay
out
of it?
How about, like, you're talking so much about how...
I don't care about your appendix. I don't care about your thorax. I don't even care about your uterus. I care about what's in it.
And I can take out my appendix if I don't want it, so why can't I take out other parts of my body?
Because they're not independent living human beings.
They're not independently living human beings when they're a bundle of cells.
Oh, okay. So let me get this. Let's assume that your scientific knowledge advanced. Let's assume your scientific knowledge. So are you also against partial birth abortion?
I think I don't understand why people would have abortion. Like,
at what point does that bundle of cells become a human being in your view?
Sorry.
Not really.
I just need to calm down for a second.
Sorry, did I forget?
Do you want to go to another question?
No, I mean, that is the relevant question. If your argument is that it's a bundle of cells, then the question becomes why it's not a bundle of cells.
Like, unless it's a threat to the mother, they form paternal abortion, it doesn't happen. But if it's a threat to the mother's health, or if a mother, like, I don't see why he would force a living human being to give birth to that.
Because it's another living human being.
So you're going to kill the mother to save the baby? And
no, hold on. You're talking about a case where the mother's life is in danger. I don't know what you're talking about.
Care and stuff after they're born.
I agree with you that abortion is an exception when the mother's life is in danger.
But the concept of bodily autonomy means that I don't have to give up any part of my body unless I say so.
The baby is not part of your body. The baby is a baby.
Really,
my wife is pregnant right now, and she's 30 weeks pregnant. Yeah. 32. That baby is kicking the living crap out of her. Okay, that is a living human being in there. Okay, and I promise you that it is not a bundle of cells. Okay, I can guarantee you it's not a bundle of cells because that is a baby. Okay, and I'm sorry.
Technically a bundle of cells that is requiring. Her
you're technically a bundle of cells, right? Now.
And it turns out I didn't need to see a black guy as president to believe that black people could be presidents in the United States. The only people who believe that are people who are misinformed about the nature of the United States by the Democratic Party and actual racists.
I'm offended by the language of uprising applied to people who are breaking into other black people's stores and looting them. This is a lack of values. And people who are destroying private property, destroying cop cars, in an uprising against what exactly? Against the black police chief, against a mostly minority police force, against the black mayor, against the black president, against the black attorney general? Against the entirely, against a city council that is 9 of 15 are black and all 15 are elected Democrats? What is the uprising against? What is it seeking to achieve? I still don't see what exactly the riots are seeking to achieve. Bottom line is, this is all, it all could be boiled down to just act like a mensch. Act like a human being. Honestly, it's not useful to riot, it's not useful to break things, it's not useful to throw rocks at people, and the idea that we're supposed to sort of correlate
let's
your level
off
of
on
outrage...
The idea. I'm going to stick to the 30 seconds on
yeah,
this.
The last sentence, the last sentence. Yeah. The idea that we're supposed to correlate your level of outrage with a certain level of justification, in other words, the more outraged you are and the more angry you are, the more justified you must be, is absolute nonsense.
Through all the most unfunny people from Comedy Central. You got Stephen Colbert, who used to be on Comedy Central and is no longer funny. Samantha Bee, who is never very funny. And Trevor Noah, who in the womb must have been just smacked with the unfunny jar. Like God took down the various jars to make a human being. And he took the humorlessness jar and he poured it all over Trevor Noah as prenatally.
People being able to accumulate wealth and the benefits throughout time.
Mm-hmm.
How can you say that hasn't put black people today at a disadvantage because of that?
It has put black people today at an initial disadvantage, but that does not mean that the rules by which they play are different than white people now. Okay, so the fact is that some people are born poor, and put race aside for a second, some people are born poor, and some people are born rich in America. Right? We can acknowledge this. Some people are born poor, and some people are born rich. That does not mean that, number one, the poor people have a right to go to the rich people and take away their money, because that's called theft. And second of all, it also does not mean that making individual good decisions does not allow the poor person to become rich. There's tremendous income mobility in the country even still. And so if the idea is that your grandfather, your great-grandfather, couldn't go to college because of the racism in the GI Bill after World War II, and that's why you flunked out of high school, I don't buy it. I don't buy it. You know, make good decisions, you will get a better result. It doesn't mean we all start in the same place. We don't. None of us start in the same place. Some of us are smarter, some of us are dumber, some of us are taller, and some of us are shorter. You know, that's the reality of life. That's just how the universe is. The question is what we do to better ourselves. And if the idea is that you get to take money from people who were not involved in your oppression in the first place in order to rectify something that happened to great-granddad, then we can play this game of historic grievance all the way down the line.
She only wanted one BlackBerry. You remember that? Not true, right? She had multiple devices on which she was viewing things. And by the way, she had more than one server. It wasn't just one in her bathroom. She had one in many bathrooms. Basically, any place that Bill had sex in the house with someone not her, she had a server.
You must speak the language of morality. The left wins because nobody on the left knows anything about politics. They know you're evil. That's it. They know you're a racist, sexist, bigot, homophobe who hates the poor. Right? That's what they know about you. And it's not they think that about you. They know that about you. Deep down, they know all these evil things about you, which is why Thanksgiving dinners are always so awkward if you're unfortunate to have Jewish relatives or you have friends on the left, which are the exact same focus group. The answer to all of this is to speak in the language of morality. This is why I never say the government compels people to do stuff. The government does not compel people to do stuff. The government compels people to do stuff at point of gun. Why do I say that? Because leftists are scared of guns. Right? When we say the government compels things, people say, oh, well, compulsion. Well, that's just like taxes, right? No. That's somebody coming to your house in the middle of the night with a SWAT team, with a gun, pointing it at you and dragging you off to prison for not doing what they want.
The reality is that this is abortion is not a complex issue. It's a very simple issue. That's either a life or it isn't. It's that simple. If it's a life, you can't kill it. If it's not a life, you can do whatever you want. It's a kidney. Right? So, and then it becomes, okay, so how do we define life? And the answer to me is you define life by the same way that you would define life if you found it on Mars, right? If you found a single-celled organism on Mars, it's a life, right? I know, as somebody who has one baby and another on the way, you know, that what's in there is not a random piece of tissue. At the very least, even if you don't believe it's a life yet, it's certainly a potential human life, and that seems to be more valuable than your convenience. And there's something nasty and cruel and degrading about the idea that you get to decide whether something is a life or not based on whether it's convenient to you or because it's in your body. By the way, this is it truly is amazing, actually, how history repeats itself. The argument in favor of abortion is exactly the same as the argument in favor of slavery. Exactly the same, right? You're on my land. I get to decide. It's up to me to decide whether you're a person or property. It's up to me, right? What are you going to say? It's on my land. What are you going to do about it?
The basic premise of socialism is I'm here, I'm breathing, give me crap. Right? You have an obligation to care for me. I have a right to health care. I can force that doctor to go to medical school, expend $200,000, spend her entire life learning medicine, and then I can walk into her house and force her to provide me medicine. Right? Capitalism, by nature, is the opposite. Capitalism is the idea that I will starve unless I give you a good or a service that you want. Right? If I don't give you something that you want, I'm not going to eat tonight. It's forced altruism, effectively. Right? We have to have a trade. We have to come to some sort of consensus. I have to give you something cool, and you have to give me something cool. Right? It's great. Socialism is rape, and capitalism is consensual sex.
There's a video that's going around the internet getting all sorts of play about income inequality. Income inequality is the stupidest issue. Income inequality means nothing. Right? I mean, I have a lot of income inequality with Bill Gates, but I'm doing pretty well, and I don't care that Bill Gates is doing really well. The only thing we should all care about is that there are poor people. We should figure out how poor people can do better, not how to make Bill Gates less rich. But this video is going around and saying, here's a poll of what Americans think the wealth distribution should look like, and here is what the wealth distribution actually looks like. And I watch this video in bewilderment, and young people love it. And I watch this video in bewilderment saying, who told you that you get to tell the universe how wealth is distributed? Right? Who told you that you have a moral say as to how wealth is distributed? It's immoral, it's evil, it's wrong. You're going to have to steal people's labor from them. But people are not told this, and so they think that their own subjective vision of what reality should look like should govern what reality actually looks like, and it's only later, after 80 years of communist failure, that they realize, oh, that, and hundreds of millions of people dead, that they realize, oh, that was a bad idea.
My wife is a doctor, okay, which means she's accomplished more in her short life than Hillary Clinton has in her entire life. My wife is a doctor who takes care of people. She never at any point in her life sat around thinking, you know what, I can't be a doctor until Hillary Clinton, a corrupt old shrew, becomes a presidential nominee. My mom, when I was growing up, my mom worked and my dad was a stay-at-home dad. And my mom didn't sit around wondering, can I run film and television companies? I don't know. I'll have to think about whether Hillary Clinton could become president. This is all so stupid. Women, by the way, are a majority of bachelor's degrees, master's degrees, and associate's degrees. Next year, according to the American Bar Association, there will be a majority of law students in the United States. American women don't need Hillary Clinton to shatter a glass ceiling that doesn't exist.
Social justice is an oxymoron. Okay, if a guilty man is acquitted because he's the right race,
That is anti-justice. If an innocent man is convicted because he's the wrong race, that's anti-justice. Social justice, however, suggests that your group identity, your identity as a person, relieves you of individual responsibility to be a decent human being. So you get to interrupt lectures if you're the right race or if you're the right gender or the right sexual orientation. You get to do these things without punishment because, after all, that's in the nature of social justice, group justice. We don't hold you responsible for your individual actions. You get extra points in heaven because you were born with a certain skin color or sexual orientation. And let me tell you something about safe spaces. There's only one group of people who want safe spaces that are race specific. There are only one group of people that want safe spaces so that they never have to hear from anybody of a different ideology or political persuasion. Those people are called fascists. Okay, and you've got a bunch of fascists, damn fascists on this campus, who are trying to shut down political debate and trying to cloister themselves in this little cocoon of stupidity so they don't have to debate anyone or think about issues outside their kin so that they can feel comfortable. Guess what? Life isn't about feeling comfortable. Life is about bettering yourself. Get off your ass, you stupid pansies.
Devices on which she was viewing things. And by the way, she had more than one server. It wasn't just one in her bathroom. She had one in many bathrooms. Basically, any place that Bill had sex in the house with someone not her, she had a server.